right, sit down, relax, take your shoes off, and welcome to This Is Bodybuilding. It's a bodybuilding podcast, it's a life podcast, it's a journal, and it's an entryway into the hearts and the minds and the lives and the souls of the people involved in the world of bodybuilding. My name's Daniel Lansfield, I'm your host, and I am a promoter, bodybuilding promoter. I'm a social media enthusiast, I'm a podcaster, and I am in the Christmas spirit, even though it's Boxing Day. Today's episode is a very special one. Sammy Ioannidis is, without a doubt, one of the most recognisable faces in Australian bodybuilding over the last 30 years or more. He's amassed state titles, national titles, world and universe titles across both the IFBB and NABBA. He's, without a doubt, one of the all-time greats. In the episode today, we talk about some of his time overseas. He was mentored by Reg Park, who also mentored Arnold Schwarzenegger for a time. He competed as a junior, and then he broke into the IFBB pro ranks before a very nasty motorbike accident derailed his pro career. It's a competitive career that spanned, I think, four decades. I think his last show was sometime in the late 2000s. I'll have to check on that. But it's fair to say that he's really seen it all. His last show was a few years ago, but since then he's made the transition over to coaching and mentoring competitors and really just giving back to the bodybuilding community, which is great to see. And of course, today's episode is brought to you absolutely free on SoundCloud, iTunes, and now Stitcher Radio. If you'd like to support the podcast in any way, please just get over to Facebook, click like, you can even leave a comment, or just share the episode with your friends in the bodybuilding community. But for now, enjoy the show. You went to the Capo powerlifting.
Yeah.
Capo or Capo, or how do you...
I don't know. Capo. I'm not into weightlifting, but I go occasionally.
It was deadlifting, wasn't it?
It was a deadlift competition, yeah.
Were you ever a big deadlifter?
Oh,
you're
no.
A big squatter?
Never.
Deadlifting?
No. I mean, I've deadlifted for fun. I've done like six plates on each side, but I've never sort of taken it up as a... I'd rather do a high rep deadlift.
Yeah. So what was the... What's the Capo deadlifting like?
No, there were a few strong guys there. I think one just lifted all my, I think it was 300 kilos.
Oof, yeah. That's a big lift.
Yeah, and I think this guy's only been training. Oh, no, actually, no. He was a guy who just did the World's Strongest Man competition in South Africa. So
He's an Aussie guy.
Yeah.
From Melbourne?
Yeah.
Nice. So was it Ange Galati's? Was it Ange's?
Yeah, Ange runs a show over there, yeah.
Did he even compete, did he?
No. He doesn't do the deadlifts. He's only a bencher.
Just a bench press.
He's a bench press. I'm a squatter. Other people do the deadlifts.
So we were talking a bit before about the NABBA universe, and you said you went for the first time in 1986.
86 was the first time, yeah.
When did you start competing? Was it around 81, 82?
No. What, you mean in comp? Just,
yeah.
I started competing in 77, I think, the same time as your dad.
Yeah, yeah.
He did the, I think he was doing powerlifting, and then he did the Southern Hemisphere.
Yep.
And I did the same show.
Okay.
I won the juniors and he won the open.
So, okay, because I've had a look at, I don't know if you've ever seen the Muscle Memory Internet Bodybuilding Database. It records, it's got records of bodybuilding competitions going back probably close to 100 years.
Yeah.
There's some really interesting stuff in there. So I type your name into it. And the first record that shows up is the 1982 IFBB World Bodybuilding Championships.
Right.
Does that sound right?
82? I'm not sure. No, it was way before that.
No, I mean, that's the first record they have
in
international competition.
Of me competing potentially, yeah.
Obviously, you competed in Australia in 77, 78.
Yeah, and also I competed in 1980, 81 in the IFBB Junior Universe in South Africa.
Okay. So that was... Was that held at the university where they ran the Olympia in the late 70s?
No, it was held in South Africa.
Yeah, but was it...
It was in Margate, run by Reg Park.
Okay, so you knew Reg pretty well then.
I ended up living with him in 1980, and then he paid for my airfare to go back in 81, defend the title.
Cool.
And I ended up staying with him again, so...
So Reg actually, he sponsored the IFBB in South Africa.
Yeah.
Was that sounds a little bit odd considering he was a NABBA Mr. Universe, he was English
and look, Reg was always, you know what, he was nothing really. He supported, he always went to the NABBA shows if he could get, you know, got a chance, and he also did a lot of promotions in the IFBB shows as well. So nobody really told Reg what he can do and what he can't do, you know.
Yeah. So
the you would have seen the photos of Reg and Arnold in the pool and that. Was that?
Oh,
sort of,
yeah, it's the same place.
Shared,
I shared
the same experience.
I shared the same bed. He shared, you know, and that room I used actually. I remember George, one of the Reg Park's servant. He's been there when before. He was there from the time John and Janice, all the kids were born. You know. Yeah. And he said that everybody slept in that bed, from Danny Padilla to Frank Zane to everyone, you know?
That's a it's a cast of...
Oh, yeah.
A famous cast there.
Yeah. And they regarded me as their Australian son, you know?
That's nice.
Just, yeah, I got invitations to all the weddings and this and that, you know? It was good.
So when was the last time... I mean, Reg has passed away now, but when was the last time you saw him?
When was the last time I saw him... I think 96, I think it was. It was in the States.
Okay.
Yeah. I ran into him occasionally. I always got calls and messages and phone calls, you know, from him.
That would have been shortly before he passed away, wasn't it?
No, he didn't pass. He passed away in...
Was it late 90s, wasn't it?
Late...
Because I remember he
late
was...
Late 90s, early 2000, something like that.
I'm pretty sure he was at the NABBA 50th year... anniversary dinner, or he may have passed away just before that, because that was 2000, I think, or 2001. They held that dinner, it would have been 2000 actually, because I remember dad was there, and it was all of the.
No, I think he was still alive then.
Yeah, well, because I know he was there, but he wasn't at the 60th year anniversary one.
No,
he was
the 60th. I think Serge Newbury was at the 60th, wasn't it? It was also his birthday.
Okay, yeah, but he
2009 he was there. I think 2008, 2009.
Yeah,
and the year later he passed away.
Yeah, very. A lot of the old, you know, the greats from that era. There's not many of them left.
Yeah.
So
see, I spent a lot of time with Serge Newbury as well.
What was he like?
No, he was good. To me, he was good. You know, a lot of people...
Well, he was French.
Yeah.
So...
You know, the French are like, say is right.
Did he speak much English?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I've seen interviews with him, and it seems to be... I mean, that was like interviews with him in the 70s and the 80s. So I guess in another 20 years, his English would have been pretty good.
No, his English was quite good, yeah.
But he mentored guys like Terry Pastel and others. So, so you sort of... got to spend a little bit of time with...
I spent a lot of time with him. He even got me to do exhibitions, I guess, at the Weber World in Switzerland. Because Weber and NABBA then were together,
Well, Serge started
Weber,
and was it 74 or 76 or something? And then it broke away in 84, which is when NABBA International started. And I mean, most people in Australia wouldn't have any idea what Weber is.
Yeah.
Although, funnily enough, Weber... has actually recently split itself. Now there's Weber World and Weber International. So it's,
Because one of Eugene Levescon in there for a while, because he still keeps in touch with me. He won his class in the university the year I won mine, you know?
Okay. Because I've seen some photos of Eugene. He was a big unit.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, no, I think he's Weber International, the one out of the UK.
Yeah, I'm not sure what he's doing at the moment. I can't recall what he's doing.
There's a lot happening over in Europe that doesn't really filter into Australia very much. But there's a hell of a lot happening over there. So going back to the beginning, when was your first contest? Was about 77.
77. I started. Like I said, I competed in the same show as your dad. He was in the seniors. I was in the juniors. So I've known your dad since 1977.
Okay.
A long time.
Oh, it's a long time.
You weren't around.
No, I wasn't around. It was 10 years later.
Yeah.
So in 77, you were a junior.
Yeah.
How old were you then?
17.
Okay, so you were 17. Okay, so when I remember you said that you won the Mr. Universe as a junior, but that was the IFBB Mr. Universe?
Yeah, well, none of us, in them days, there weren't many competing in NABBA. You know,
yeah.
NABBA wasn't really big in Australia.
Yeah,
it wasn't until later. You know,
but Paul Graham was running the IFBB.
Paul Graham was running the IFBB.
Was it?
Rocco was running the PWBI.
And
so then both them, they were the two powerful federations at the time.
Dad told me the story once, and it was they all went to the IFBB Universe. It was in the early 80s, and there was a split between
I was there at the same time.
And I think it was Peter McCarthy.
Paul Graham and was it Joe Lopez?
No,
Peter McCarthy.
Peter McCarthy.
Yeah.
So I mean, yeah, I don't know, you being in, you based in Melbourne.
I'm not sure who I went. I think I went with, we competed in 82. It was the Bruges, Belgium.
Yeah, because dad was in Sydney. So he went with Paul Graham.
I must have gone with Paul. I can't remember. I must have gone with Paul Graham too.
But basically what happened was the Peter McCarthy had his team representing Australia and Paul Graham had his team representing Australia.
Yeah.
And the way Dad tells it, they asked for representatives from each from Australian bodybuilding to get up and speak on behalf of one or the other. So Dad stood up and spoke on behalf of Paul Graham and said, yeah, he should be the president. And following the 1982 IFBB universe, Paul Graham was endorsed officially as the IFBB Australia president. Is that
happened? Well, we ended up competing. Your dad competed. I competed. I can't remember who else.
I think competed. I think he still got the. You remember we used to get the like the team
jacket. Was it yellow and black, blue or something? Yeah, orange and blue. Yellow. Yeah, and blue.
It wasn't. I don't think it was a jacket. It was like a. I mean, did you ever go to Japan?
No.
When they held the universe in Japan? No. Your dad went to Japan once and they gave him all kimonos. They were green and gold style kimonos. Yeah. So after you started off as a junior, you did the 1986 NABBA universe.
Yeah.
Prior to that, though, you were competing in the IFBB.
In IFBB, yeah.
So what were your first overseas trip? Do you remember that with the IFBB?
Yeah, it was the junior universe.
Okay.
1980, yeah, I won that. I stopped competing as a junior when I was 19.
Jeez, all right.
Because
you're too big for
they didn't want me to. Paul Graham said to me that they weren't getting enough juniors competing because of me.
Yeah.
So I stopped competing. I was just doing open class, like the Open Melbourne and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Victoria, and I won them. And then in 1980. He rang me up and said that they're going to send a contestant to the Junior Universe.
Okay.
And he asked me to compete in the Junior Australian Championship. So I went over and competed in that, flew over to South Africa, and fortunately I won it.
Yep.
And then the following year, when I was there, Reg Park said, look, I'm going to pay for your airfares to come and defend your title.
Cool.
Which was good. So I got back here, then Paul Graham went to run a show, and I said to him, I'm not competing because I'm already going over. Mm-hmm. And then he did end up running the show. He wasn't happy. And I just, because Reg had already paid my ticket, so he's going to run a show and I'm going to go anyhow.
Yeah.
So I went.
So was he running the Mr. Universe again the following year?
Reg ran it again the following year. And I think the year after that, it was in Switzerland. Another Aussie competed and he came second. I think he competed in one of your shows too. Mike.
Is he still competing now?
No, he's a personal trainer.
Mike. I don't know. I've known a lot of Mike, so over the years.
I can't pick his name
now. I'm thinking Mike Souza.
Michael Innes.
Oh, okay, Michael Innes, yeah. Yeah,
Michael Innes, I think, came second in Switzerland.
Yeah.
The year after that,
yeah.
Sean Ray won it in Queensland.
Oh, they held the...
Yeah, they held the Junior Universe in
Switzerland. So, we said the Junior Universe. All it was just the juniors.
I think they were running the IPB Juniors and the Masters.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't know if they don't think they're running anymore, but he won it like a few years after me, 3 years after me, Sean Ray. See, the difference is he got on every American cover magazine, sponsors and stuff like that, where we got nothing.
Yeah.
You know? We flew back here.
And you come home and
nothing.
No one gives a shit.
No publicity, nothing at all. This guy here was, you know, raking in sponsorships and cover of every magazine.
I mean, that's more or less the same as it is now.
Yeah, yeah. And really changed. It's not even that big in America anymore, you know?
No.
Well, I mean, it's still very much a niche. The same.
No. Yeah. And then, look, I don't know. I always find it funny when people talk about pro bodybuilding because you think, you know, there's really only... It's not even the top 10% of bodybuilders. It's top...
Probably six of them are making money.
Yeah. there's the top guys. And I say guys deliberately because I'd say that the women in bodybuilding, I've spoken to...
Yeah,
I had a chat to Monica Brandt overseas, and
Did the NABBA, didn't she?
Yeah, she did the NABBA, but you know, even she was saying like the money available to women and the exposure the positive exposure available to women just isn't the same as what it is for the guys.
Yeah.
So that there's just such a disincentive for you know, for women to keep going and going, whereas for some of the top guys, they can,
yeah,
you know, keep doing it for forever and a day and keep.
And they make their little bits and pieces from doing their sponsorships, exposures, guest posing, stuff like that. So.
And other, you know, there's a lot, of, things, there's a lot of other things on the side.
Yeah, you know, but a lot of them, look, the top, probably about six will be making good money. Because they're constantly doing exhibitions, traveling around the world, especially when they go to Dubai and places like that, you know.
But I don't know, it seems nowadays that the main thing that they're all focused on is their social media presence.
Yeah, and yeah, they're all, I don't know, yeah.
Like, you grew up in the era of bodybuilding where when you did a contest, unless you called someone or wrote them a letter or sent them, you know, something, they wouldn't find out what the results are.
Of course.
Yeah, you know, a month or two after the
contest. Yeah, 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 of course, yeah.
So, do you think that social media has affected bodybuilding negatively? Or competitors negatively?
I don't know. Well, it's, you know what, with social media, it gets, there's, what I find that there's too many, there's too much going on social media.
Yeah.
Everybody's a pro, everybody's this, everybody, and you don't even hear about them. You don't even know who they are.
Yeah.
But they're pros, you know?
I see people on Facebook and it's like, you know, something such and such a pro fitness model or pro sports this or pro bodybuilder. I'm like, I've never even heard of you. I've never seen you compete.
No.
And, you know, apparently you're, you know, yeah.
Well, it's ridiculous.
A universe title holder or an Olympia title holder.
You know, every country can run a local show and give a pro card. You can be Mr. Ethiopia, Mr. Whatever, Nigeria, and you're never going to compete.
Yeah.
But you know, to compete in them countries and to do bodybuilding in them countries, you got to be from a wealthy family.
Yeah.
So they don't care about paying $1,000 for their pro card, and they'll keep it going, but they'll never get a chance to compete. They'll never compete, you know, and then they don't care. The weirdos are still getting, all the federation is still getting $1,000 off them.
Yeah,
it's not like NABBA, WFF. You get it, you know, you win all these shows and you can compete, and you know, and all these. You know, they're not giving a pro card to the Mr. Ethiopia and stuff like that, NABBA and all that. You know. Yeah.
Well, with NABBA, you still got to win the universe, you win. Of the worlds.
Yeah, yeah, you got to win titles.
I mean, I don't know. There's plenty of. It's funny. There's a lot of IFBB guys out at the moment who have tried their luck at the NABBA universe and didn't get anywhere.
No. Yeah.
But they're, you know, they're on the IFBB pro circuit.
Then there's the NABBA guys who've won, and they go and they're doing really well. Like Lionel just won a
Lionel Bjerke,
a show. He won the 2009, I think, was it? Universe.
Yeah.
8 or 9? I was there.
Eight. So was that wasn't, you did the over 40s? Well, you were there in 2009 as well, doing the over 50s.
2009, yeah. Well, they're gonna that year. I just started coming back, just had my back operation. I only trained for about 6 weeks for it.
Okay.
So the following year, I was ready. Like, now I'm ready too. If I want to compete, it's easy for me because I've maintained shape.
Are you announcing a comeback?
No. I don't know. But I know that I'm not far away from contest shape. I want to be there because I've been training now.
Yeah.
Them days I took like 15 years off, and I try to make a comeback in 5 weeks. You know, it's different.
Oh, well, Kevin Lavroni did it in what, 6 months? So.
Yeah, but you don't want to look like that. I look like what Kevin Ravlani looked at the first year, but the second year was completely different. Yeah, you know? Get different quality.
Well, I guess you know, once you get that consistency back, it's
It takes a bit of time. You know, I knew Lavroni wouldn't do anything, not coming back like that. But you give him another couple of years, he'll get better and better.
Yeah,
but he's never going to be like he used to be because he's taking too much of a layoff.
I guess the hardest thing for him is he's 50, isn't he? 40,
yeah, it'd be late 50. 40, maybe. Be 50.
You know, each year he might come back and he might get better, but at the same time he's still getting older.
Of course, so his body's not going to get that quality.
While he's getting, he might be getting better. It's always going to be he's getting better for his age.
Yeah,
it's not that he's getting better and he's got, you know, another 20 years.
No, he's not going to get like. I mean, he must be dreaming if he thinks he's going to get like he used to be.
Yeah, but I mean,
I'm the same. There's no way in the world I'm going to get that quality. There's no way. Your body changes. Your waist gets wider, your hips get wider, you're this, you know, you can't help it, you know.
Yeah. So I've seen a photo, it's a great old photo of you, Charles Claremont, and Oscar Heidenstam at the Universe, I think it was 88, would have been the year. It might have actually been 86 because he.
No, it was 86 because that was 86. Eugene Laviscon was in it too. You're talking about that black and white one.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was Eugene, myself. I'm on the ground. And, yeah.
I thought that was Charles Clermont.
It's Charles Clermont, Eugene Laviscon. There's three of us. And
oh, that's right. You were in the
and
front.
Oscar, yeah, and yeah, Oscar yeah, in the middle.
Oscar's in the middle. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So, well, you were the three class winners.
Class winners, yeah.
Obviously, Charles Clermont went on to win the Pro Universe three times, and then moved over to the IFBB. You took a similar route. You didn't go into the Pro Universe, did you?
No.
So you went.
I did the.
So you did the Niagara Falls Pro Invitational.
I've done Niagara Falls a few times.
Yeah.
Chicago, New York Night of Champions.
So how did it, back in the late 80s, early 90s, how did you get into the IFBB Pro Circuit? Was it purely on invitation, or
yeah,
did
they were after me.
Okay.
Because I did the three universes.
Yeah.
I always came. I come first, second.
Yeah.
So they were always after me, you know. And everybody, the people who beat me all ended up winning the overall.
Okay. Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it was out of whoever won it. Well, that one year it was
Victor Terra, yeah.
The year I lost to Charles Clermont, I think I should have won. And a lot of people thought I should have won because there's write-ups on it because he was a little bit flat, smooth in the legs and stuff like that. But they say they wrote that some of the English magazines wrote this time here the smaller guy should have beaten the bigger guy. And stuff like that, but it doesn't matter. And then the following year, I lost to Victor Terra by half a point, I reckon. All right, and
that's tough to call.
Yeah, but how can you say half a point? Yeah. All right, lost to Victor Terra. And the following year, it was Jerry Scalise, who's supposed to be about 5'8", competing to 5'6".
Okay.
Yeah, he competed under five. All the magazines you read, he's 5'9" or something, you know.
Yeah.
And he competed under 5'6". Because they had another guy in the other class, and actually Scalise was taller than the guy who won. It was in the medium class. I forget that guy. Not 100%. There was someone else. But they had two guys in the universe, and they both won their classes.
Okay.
And everybody was saying to me, "Oh, you should put in a complaint." What for? I mean, if I would have had to come against him if I won my class in the next class if he was in the other class.
Yeah.
You know? If he beat me, you know. So that was 3 years where I could have won the overall, you know what I mean? And so the IPB, that's how they approached me. They saw that I was getting a lot of publicity in England.
Yeah.
I was always on the cover of their magazines and this and that.
So it wasn't back then it wasn't a process of having to do a pro qualifier. It was just, Paul Graham approached you and said,
Paul Graham, it was Wayne D'Amelio.
Okay.
He got in touch with me, and then he got in touch with Tony Doherty.
Yep.
Because I wasn't talking to Paul Graham at the time.
Yeah.
Because of all the other shit that was going on. And then because Paul Graham had nothing to do with the pros.
Yeah.
See, he doesn't control the pro part of it.
That's just...
He only controls the amateurs.
Yes. So the pro stuff goes directly to the USA.
Yeah. So then Wayne D'Amelio got in touch with me, and they were writing me letters and this and that. And then I went through Tony Doherty.
Yeah.
And Tony were debating with, you know, working out with him. And then they ended up signing me up.
Mm.
And I did well on my first show. I came seventh in Niagara Falls.
Yeah.
But I got better and better. But the thing is, because I was coming back home, you weren't going to get nowhere.
Yeah.
You know? The last show I did was, I think, 94. Kevin Lavrone goes to me, "Hey, we got to go backstage. The finals." I said to him, "I'm not in the finals." He goes to me, "I thought it was out of us three for the you, me, and Porter Cottrell for first place." I said, "Nah." And then Mike Matarazzo goes to me, "I've got to tell you the top 10 place before you even came." You know, that's how political they are, you know?
Yeah.
Because whoever's had a weeder contract, then it's going to do well.
Well, I remember reading an interview with Charles Clermont.
Mm-hmm.
It was a recent one, actually, and he was talking about the same sort of thing, that the guys who, because he got a weeder contract in the early 90s,
he was doing well then,
but he was on the IFBB Pro Circuit for probably, I don't know, 7 or 8 years doing a lot of stuff, and then I think he sort of dropped off after that, got burned out. But he said that the guys who are all on the weeder contracts
Or in a place.
Well, his feeling was that they were given preferential treatment, but the guys who were, I think it was a story he was telling about, they had booked a photo shoot, and only him and one other guy from England showed up. Might have been like Ernie Taylor or someone. And they were the only two guys who showed up, and they were talking to the photographer like, "Where's everyone else?" And they're like, "Oh yeah, they don't worry about this. Like, you guys are worried about keeping your contract. No one else gives a shit because they're already here.
They live there.
Yeah. So for the guys who desperately needed that contract, they'd just do whatever they had to do.
I think the only one who did well who didn't live there was Dorian Yates.
Yeah.
Well, even Sonny, when he left and came back, he never played again.
Yeah.
You know? There was Akim, someone, a German guy.
Yeah.
He was doing really well when he was in the States. As soon as he went back to live in Germany, he never played again.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't know, like Marcus Ruhl.
All them guys.
Gunter Steenkamp, they all had to sort of do that half and half living.
Yeah, you have
to
live in the States half the time, yeah. Because Weider wants to use you all the time. There's no good. Look, it was no good for you to win competitions and leave, and you can't use it for any publicity, advertising, and stuff like that.
I guess it makes sense when you've got the media machine, or when you're running the media machine, you need that. What was the first magazine cover you were on? Because I remember, I think I'm pretty sure I've seen you on.
I've been a lot of Rocco's magazines.
Yeah, I think Dad's got some at the gym with you on the cover.
And American magazines, Muscle Training Illustrated, Dan Laurie one.
Okay.
And I was in a lot of the center shots as well, like Man of what do they have, all the main.
Yeah. Photos. Dan Laurie used to run the World Bodybuilding Guild.
AAU or something. He trained Lou Ferrigno.
Yeah.
And guys like that.
The AAU was the American, when they had bodybuilding, was the American Athletic Union, or the Amateur Athletic Union.
I think they were with NABBA, weren't they?
No, they used to ban people. They were, funnily enough, the AAU was the very first organization that would ban people if they competed in a non-AAU sanctioned event.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Because what they said was that if you competed in NABBA or the IFBB, that they would not consider you to be an amateur anymore, and the AAU was only for amateur competitors. If you were taking that step into what they considered a more professionally because it was dedicated to bodybuilding, they considered it professional. Whereas the AAU's contests, they'd tack on bodybuilding at the end of a strongman contest or weightlifting or powerlifting or something. So it had a little bit of a different flavor to it.
A lot of them went through there. Like the AAU, every time you saw Dan Laurie, he'd be with Suze Newbray or Lou Ferrigno or some of the other big names, you know?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think the AAU in the 70s and 80s was probably on par with the IFBB.
Yeah, he was competitive. He was competing against Weider.
They do the Mr. World AAU and Mr. Universe AAU and Mr. America. And like a lot of the guys who were in Pumping Iron, a lot of the titles they had were AAU titles, IFBB.
Yeah,
But it was just that Olympia title that really elevated.
Yeah,
it, and that's of course. What everyone sort of wanted to.
And there weren't many in it then.
No,
75. What, there were three contestants in the tall class?
Well,
there's only Arnold, Lou Ferrigno, and Sid Newbrain at all.
Yeah, but it's funny. A lot of people don't know, like Sergio Oliva. He competed unopposed in the Mr. Olympia.
Yeah, that's right. That's why he won.
Okay, there's not a contest then, is it?
Yeah,
It's just they gave this one guy a trophy for showing up because no one else showed up to compete against him.
Yeah.
So, but you know, you don't really get that anymore, do you?
No. Now you got heaps of contestants.
When was the last time you went to a show?
Bodybuilding show?
Yeah.
What do you mean went?
Like competed, but do you go? I go every year. I mean, I see you around the traps.
I go to all the shows, as many as I can.
Yeah.
I go to all the NABBA shows. I go to a few shows because there's people competing, which I know. I go to IMBA.
You still train people in that thing?
Yeah. Oh, that's all I do now, just train people.
So you're working at a Body World Balaclava?
Yeah, it's just a
right. That's because you had your gym in
Thornbury.
Thornbury.
Hmm.
And that, you had that for a long time, didn't you?
30 years.
Yeah, geez.
Yeah. Landlord wanted the building back, and that was it.
Are they building apartments there?
I don't know what they're doing.
I don't know. All of that
The whole of High Street, whole of High Street's apartments.
Yeah, it's going crazy.
Yeah.
So with Bodyworld Balaclava, do you own? You don't own that gym, do you?
No. I wouldn't own a gym. Your dad knows that too. Forget it. It's just like, you know what? From the age of 22 to what, 40, 50, I was working at a gym from morning to night, 7 days a week. Les and I were there.
Drive you insane.
Oh, I think the best thing ever, what had happened was that the landlord wanted the building back.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I enjoy what I'm doing now. Yeah. I work 28, 30 hours a week.
You don't have to run around after people and tell them to pick up their weights or...
30 hours a week.
Scream at people and get checked.
I work a couple of hours in the morning.
Yeah.
And then I'm home at 11 or 12 o'clock. I do my workout. I'm home at 12 o'clock. And I go back at 6 p.m., train another three. It's enough.
It's all right.
With six people a day, you're then you're 30 hours a week.
It's about a lifestyle more than anything.
You know, you make a couple of grand a week and you do nothing.
It's all right.
You work 30 hours.
They tell the tax.
And it doesn't even feel like you're working.
Yeah.
Seriously, it doesn't feel like you're working because, you know, like I've worked today. I went this morning, I've trained people from 8 o'clock till 1.
Yeah.
And you train your five people and then you got all day free. Don't even feel like you've worked. You know, because, you know, you're training people hard. Yeah. But you're like socializing at the same time. You enjoy doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
Putting through the paces, this, that, you know. And before you know it, there's 5 hours are gone. And it's only 1 o'clock. You know?
Do you wake up at like 5 in the morning and do cardio and all that kind of stuff?
Or I got to get my cross. I used to do cross training every morning just because I enjoy doing it, you know. Yeah. It loosens me up. But I got to get up here. I don't think it'll fit through the door, you know. I just need to adjust a few things. Extend on the balcony, put my electric blind and maybe put the cross train out there.
Oh, yeah.
I want to have one going from outside all the way down. Just press a button, close it up.
That'd be right. Well, you got a nice view outside the tennis courts.
Oh, yeah.
At night,
it's all lit up.
Were you ever a tennis player?
No, but I sometimes go across there with my kids and just play. It's good cardio. I love it. I love running around, getting the kids to run. And,
yeah. Well, there's a lot of people in bodybuilding nowadays that really don't like cardio, and they really they're promoting hard against doing cardio.
I enjoy doing it. It's not that I'm not doing it because I just feel fitter doing it.
Yeah.
The others are doing it more reasons for bodybuilding and for growth and thinking I'm going to get leaner. I'll get leaner doing it and stuff like that. I just do it because I enjoy doing it.
When you competed, were you like?
I do a lot of cardio when I compete to start with.
Yep.
And then I back off and do zero.
Is that more just to kickstart your metabolism?
Kickstart my metabolism, you know. And then once I'm in shape, I just back off.
Yeah.
Well, cut it from 45 minutes down to 20 minutes, down to 10 minutes, down to nothing.
Yeah.
And then I don't do any more, you know.
Because when Lee Priest came out of retirement...
He was doing 3 hours a day.
Yeah, he used to send us photos. And he was
three or four hours a day.
But I think he was sort of in his own head, like he's got a... You know, this was it for him, that he hadn't been on stage in 6-7 years. If he gets on stage and he doesn't look his best, you know, he's going to feel it psychologically. So he put a lot of pressure on himself.
He, you know, like he was very nervous. He was like, you know... kept in touch with me all the time.
Yeah.
He was scared. He was shitting himself, you know? Yeah. Because everybody's out to beat him. He's got everything to lose and nothing really to gain.
Yeah.
You know, everything to lose because by him losing the show, not placing, he's, ruined his name.
Reputation's on the line.
Yeah.
I mean, he ended up winning that show.
Yeah.
And I think that for him was, he was comfortable to retire on that. I know of some people who pay upwards of $1,500 posing courses with certain pros.
Yeah.
And I just find that completely insane.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know...
Because your posing routine means nothing.
Well,
it doesn't because it's only short now. A lot of federations don't even have a routine.
Yeah, I can't fathom that, but...
It's only a 30-second, 45-second routine.
Well, look...
The most important thing is to perfect your compulsories and your relax stands. Because that's what wins you the show. Because your routine, you go out there, like you never seen all the pro shows.
Yeah.
You do your routine first.
Yeah.
And then they line you up for relax. And that's what...
your routine, I look at it and I say, okay, that's the entertainment portion of it. And I look at bodybuilding the same way that I look at the pro wrestling, the WWE.
Yeah.
I look at it as it's sports entertainment. There's a sports element to it.
Yeah.
And there's definitely a sporting element to it. But when you actually go to a competition, a bodybuilding competition, it's more about sports entertainment than it is.
Yeah, of course.
Because all of the actual sporting aspect of it is done beforehand.
All the training.
That's all done in the gym.
Yeah.
You know, very little can change on the day that's yeah. going to... Okay, unless you wolf down 3 Big Macs or you drink a liter of Gatorade or you do something that really messes up your condition. Yeah, you've done everything you can do, but it all happens beforehand.
Of course.
When you get there on the day...
You're just showing what you've done.
Yeah.
Over the whole year.
It's more like an art art contest or something. But, I mean, posing for you was always pretty easy.
Yeah. I just make it up.
So...
I've never practiced posing. I don't even take music with me. I always say, have you got any music?
Well, I think every time I've seen you compete, it was always AC/DC. It's always Back in Black or Thunderstruck or...
Yeah, I've done a few of them.
I think I've only seen...
I think I posed to Ride Like the Wind.
Yeah.
Crisscross.
Yeah.
I've done that, same as Tom Platz, that one. Look, it doesn't work. Look, you know, with me, it doesn't worry me. I just got to listen to the music. And I think, oh, that's it. That's all right. Mm. Go out there and do a routine. Because you know what? Nobody knows what your routine's like. And then you just move from pose to pose, you know? Smile, move from pose to pose. Nobody knows what you're supposed to be doing. I tell people that when I'm teaching them, when I go through their posing, I tell them, you know, and then all of a sudden you see they've missed the pose and they're thinking. I said, what are you thinking about? Just move. Nobody knows what your routine is.
Yeah.
So you know how people sometimes get on stage and they stop and think, fuck, I fucked it up, you know? You haven't fucked anything up. Just keep on going. Nobody knows what you're doing.
Yeah. Well, that's the other thing. If you've got 90 seconds, I always tell people, look, get 15 to 20 poses that you know that you can do, right? And then take 3 to 4 seconds to get into each one.
When I came back in 2008 and competed, nobody told me how much time you had on stage.
So you just got out there and...
Didn't do anything. I got out there, stood relaxed on the front, relaxed on the side, relaxed on the back, relaxed back to the front.
Yeah.
And then I started and they turned the music off. And then later on, I think your dad said to me, oh, you only got so many seconds. And I'm thinking, fuck, I didn't even know. Yeah, but the following year, I just walked up there and just did all my best poses.
Yeah.
Boom, bang, leg shots, ab shots, you know, that. And it was great. So because you know what I thought, oh, just hit anything. You don't need a routine. You're just going to hit your best poses.
So did you do the Aussies? No, you would have done the Aussies in 2008 and 9.
Yeah.
To go to the universe.
Yeah.
So you would have been up against Justin Wessels on stage with him. No. So he won the Aussies 8, 9 and 10, I think.
No, I don't think I did the Aussies. I just done Victoria.
You just did the Vicks?
Yeah.
I guess no one's going to...
Yeah, I just did the Vicks. That was it. And then I won that and I went over to the universe. So
what was it like going back to England after all those years? It was sort of
I loved it.
20 years.
Everybody there was wrapped to see me and all the judges, the officials. I was just like...
We saw Ian Harrison was there this year. I don't know if you remember him.
Oh, of course I remember him. He competed against me as a pro as well.
Yeah. So he lives in the States now, but he was back.
Yeah, he
years.
Lives in Florida. Yeah.
Yeah, he was hanging out with Eddie Elwood and other guys. So.
Yeah, Eddie actually wrote to me the other yesterday. I always keep in touch with these guys.
Yeah.
Keeps on telling me to come up every year. Says to me, come over. You know, even if I don't compete, just come over. You can stay with me, and we'll go and hang around. You know, because I've known these guys for ages. Yeah. You know, Eddie and Elwood and I were competing pro as well.
And in the IFBB.
Together. And then we used to go and hang, because we knew each other from London, we used to hang around together as well. Him, his missus, myself.
He's about, 6'4" or something.
Six five. He's a monster. Yeah. And then Ian Harrison, the same. There's a few shots I posted recently with me, Rich Gaspari, and all that. And Ian Harrison's in the back as well.
Yeah.
But Ian came out here and he reckons that I was a big influence in his bodybuilding because he was there when I won the universe. He won the juniors, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah. Well, he would have been because I remember.
Yeah, he won the.
You know, Michael Melksham.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was Taipan on Gladiators. I don't know what happened to him. He just after Gladiators.
He's still around.
Is he?
Yeah.
I'd love to meet him.
His sister, Elaine Melsham, she used to compete as well.
Well, but him and his wife were Taipan and... he was Taipan and I can't remember his wife was another gladiator.
Was it his wife or his girlfriend? I can't remember.
I'm not sure. Might have been his
girlfriend.
But
I've known him for years.
But she was a gladiator as well. Yeah. But Michael was the first Australian to win the Junior NABBA Universe.
Yeah.
So... He would have been, yeah, I don't know, 19. I
can't remember what year it was.
That was 89, I think. But if Ian Harrison, I think, would have been.
Was another guy won the Junior Universe as well? He came and borrowed all my books, and he was training, all my training books. He used to hang around Michael Melsham.
I don't know.
He came to your show recently. He was at the backstage here walking around helping people. He's just covered in tattoos now.
Ooh, I don't know.
He was at your show.
A bloke in bodybuilding covered in tattoos.
He's covered everywhere now. Everywhere from head to toe.
Yeah. I'm not sure. What's his name now? There's a lot of guys over the years that have done...
No, but he's won the NABBA Junior Universe.
Oh. Recently or 20 years? Oh, geez, I don't know.
Or maybe it might have been IPB. No, it was NABBA.
I think there's only like one or two guys from Australia that have ever won the
Juniors. He might have won the IPB because I remember helping him come to my gym, borrowed all my training books and stuff. He wanted to copy the routines, you know? Yeah, like fuck. It would have been fuck trying to train like that. They were killer routines.
How many guys come up to you nowadays and trying to pick your brain for...
Oh, every day. I get every day. And just not on Facebook. Everywhere, you know?
That's that added aspect of social media. Once upon a time, you could turn your phone off at the end of the day and no one would bother you.
Yeah.
Now, it doesn't matter what you do. Everyone's barking down your door.
And most of the time, I tell... You know what? I'm pretty cool with helping out people. I just tell them to give me a call, come pass, you know? Yeah.
In the mid-90s, you had Dennis James was competing in the NABBA Pro Universe. Eddie Elwood. I think Eddie beat Dennis once. And then there were...
Shane Stratton beat Dennis.
Yeah. There were plenty of guys on the scene. Like, you look at the old footage of the 90s NABBA Universe, it's fantastic.
Yeah, yeah.
But they all do it once or twice, and then they go off the IFBB.
Mm.
There's no...
They don't stay there, yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't follow.
Only because they're after the money. And they think if we go to the IFBB, they run 20 pro shows a year.
But as you say, unless you're living in the US, it's very difficult to get the exposure that really drives your
thing. I like that thing. Josh is doing all right at the moment.
Yeah.
Let's see how he goes. He's only doing all right because of Tony as well. None of the Aussies that went over there now placed.
I saw, what's his name? Atif and...
they all went over.
Atif went over and he got like... 7th or 8th or something, and Abel's are back.
Yeah, what did he get?
Was over. He placed one... I think he got one place better than Atif.
Yeah.
So, you know, but I guess they're still in the mix, but when...
But the shows like, they did...
You look at the top three lower, guys?
The shows they did are the lower part of the shows. Well, they're not the top shows.
You look at the guys who placed 1st, 2nd, and 3rd, and those are names that you'll probably see in the Olympia.
In the Olympia, yeah.
And because of the way the Olympia has, you got to qualify, get a certain number of points.
Yeah, you got to get the
top
three.
They fly these guys around just to token win shows to get their points up. And everyone else who competes, okay, unless you're like, you've made a huge improvements and you just blast everyone out of the water.
Yeah.
You really just, I don't know.
It's a number.
Well,
just fill up. Yeah.
All right, just, yeah.
You well, they're never going to get bodies on stage. None of them are going to do anything anyhow. How's Ab now?
Abe. I don't know, he was 31, I think, when he started with NABBA, and that was back in 08. So he'd be coming close to 40.
And at 40 years old, if you haven't done anything? Because he's had a few years off where he's got to try and improve, and hasn't done anything.
He took 2 years off. He won his...
The worst thing he did was leave NABBA, because he came second in the universe or world.
And then second or third, yeah.
Yeah, and he never competed again. He decided to go pro.
Yeah.
IFBB pro, come on, you know.
Well, I mean, you've been there. What?
The worst thing I ever did. I could have won about 6 NABBA Universe, 7 NABBA Universes.
Well, when you I guess, retired from the IFBB Pro League,
yeah.
was that a decision that you just went out?
No, I had a motorbike accident.
So, okay, so...
I did my back, that's why I stopped.
Okay.
So, otherwise, I would have still done something. I don't think I would have gone back to the IFBB. I was in good shape then.
Yeah. What year was that? It was late...
2004.
Oh, so you were still competing as a pro up until...
Oh, sorry, no, it was 94.
Okay.
94, 95, 96, around there.
Because I remember seeing...
Yeah, no, it was 94, 95, 96.
Okay.
2009 is when I came, 2008, 2009 when I came back, but that's when I hurt myself. But it was, I think I was in best shape ever then. I was competing at 103 Ks.
Whoa.
You know?
And you're 5'4"?
5'5".
Fuck.
And big. I had, yeah.
That's really big.
Yeah. Jesus and I had, God. And I had my motorbike accident then, and then that was it. That stuffed me up.
So do you still have any lingering pain from that accident?
Oh, yeah. My back's stuffed all the time. It's wrecked.
Didn't stop you from keeping squatting, though.
No, I can't do it now because I tore a hammy a couple of years ago and that's it. It stopped me from... Now I can hardly squat.
So what do you do for legs now?
I just do leg press, single leg presses, hack squats, leg extensions. I squat, but I only do like a...
I guess...
10 Ks on each side, or sometimes I might use 20 Ks on each side. But, you know, what? Up until a couple of years ago, I was doing 50 reps with... You know, 120 Ks. But then I tore my hammy, and that threw everything out, threw my back out, threw everything out.
I saw a video the other day of a guy doing...
180.
You 180, lock.
Did 42 reps?
42 or 47 reps, something.
No, it was 42. He was going for 50.
180 kilos.
Yeah, I reckon I could have done it.
That's the thing, you know.
There's
not many people.
I did 120 with a fused back. You know what I mean?
You and Tom Platts would be the... Yeah, there's not that many guys out there that would do...
It's just the repetitions that get you.
Yeah.
It's not the, you know...
Well, I suppose, but...
Look, I've squatted 7 plates before. But...
nearly 200 kilos.
7 plates is more than 200.
210.
20, 40, 60, 80, 100, 120, 140,
180, 280,
300.
300
kilos?
Yeah.
No. Yeah. The 20 kilo plates, and I've squatted 7 on each side.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
You think that's like...
No, my legs... Look, I've never had sore knees. I still haven't got sore knees.
You're lucky.
Yeah, never had sore knees. Never had a sore back, apart from when I had the accident.
Yeah.
And now, you know, I'm cautious when I pick up something. I'm cautious with my back. Because I'm thinking, fuck, I can do it. And then, if I have to squat 4 or 5 plates, I'll do it. I'll be fucked, but, you know. It's like I tell people, I can do anything.
Yeah.
Like the other day, I took JD and this other guy through a workout. I said, come on, I'll train with you. I destroyed him. Because if I train, I can train heavy and fast.
Yeah.
You know, like I'll set up a bench. I'll set up an incline. I'll set up incline flies, flat flies, pullovers, dips, cable crossovers. And I'll get him to follow me. And, you know, at one stage I should do everything with 100-pound dumbbells, 110-pound dumbbells, flies, incline flies, pullovers, dips, just hang them on there.
Yeah.
And these guys follow, and then by the end of it, they're doing like fucking 3-4 reps. Yeah, but I'm still repping them out, you know, 12. You know, I've still got the endurance to do all that, but my shoulders are fucked. It's bone on bone.
Ugh. You haven't had an arthroscope or anything?
I need 2 shoulder replacements.
Jeez. Dad had the knee.
I'm gonna. I get back from overseas, I'll ring up and book them because they're all motorbike accidents. This is another accident I had when I got back from the universe 2009. I come off fucked both shoulders and ended up in hospital.
Oof.
Come off in the rain. Both shoulders. I was looking at the photo the other day. Neck brace, shoulders. God. You know.
Do you still ride?
Yeah.
You still got your bike?
I got my scooter downstairs, but I don't have a big bike anymore. Just a scooter.
Was it a Vespa?
Yeah, a little Vespa, but I only ride to the gym and back. I won't go nowhere.
That's right.
Yeah. I've got my car, that's all.
Yeah. Much safer.
Yeah. But because the gym's around the corner, it takes me 3 minutes on the scooter. It takes me 5 minutes with the car, but because it's summer.
I've been thinking about getting a scooter.
Mm-hmm.
What's the mileage like on there? You get a full tank of petrol and...
I put...
Is it 10 litres?
$5, $5 petrol.
Yeah.
Mine's only 50cc, it goes 80 kilometres an hour.
Hey, that's enough.
I know, yeah. I know, because, you know, 80 kilometres an hour and I get 180 Ks out of $5.
Jeez.
I know.
That's really good.
It goes a month. Wow. I only go to the gym and back, takes a month. And my, because I got my car, I only drive here and back anyhow. That it takes me 3 weeks. And I got the.
Do you need a special license because it's a 50cc?
You still need a license. Yeah. Still, that's. A license is easy to get. One of the girls I was training, she just went and got her license. She'd probably kill herself. Crazy.
It's not funny. I shouldn't laugh.
No, she's fucking crazy.
But well, she got a motorbike license.
Yeah, you know that Sarah.
I don't know. There's a lot of Sarah.
Blonde one. I brought it to your show last time.
Blonde Sarah. Oh, man, there's a lot of Sarahs.
Yeah, blonde Sarah. The one.
I don't know, the one I was sitting next to. I still, I remember.
Yeah. She came down
with the two girls. You came in and brought them to the show.
Oh, it's like three of them came, and I'm thinking, fuck, they're all sitting around. Everybody's going.
Next time, get them on stage. We'll get them to give out some trophies.
Yeah, because they're all. Lucinda was there.
Okay. Yeah,
all right,
yeah.
And then her girlfriend was there, and then Sarah came as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you, I don't know. You got all the chicks.
Fuck! I have them here all the time. You know.
The bachelor pad.
Oh well, now I've got. I don't start. No, I've got no relations with none of them, and whoever wants to come around, you know, they're all like, if they want to root, they can come around. If they want to hang around, they can come around. They can't come around here when my kids are here every Friday, every second Friday, Saturday.
So, ladies and gentlemen, you hear it here first. If you want to come to Sammy's place, for a root,
get a cook,
don't do it on a Friday night.
Now Fridays and Saturdays, I have my kid. My son stays here, but because we're going to Thailand on Wednesday, I said to him, stay with your mum.
Yeah.
And his mother said, oh, you pick up Ethan and Paris. I said, no, they're staying with you because you're not going to see Ethan for 7 weeks, you know. But he's going to be wrapped because we're going to go to Thailand for 3 weeks. We're going to come back, stay 1 week here. Then we're going to Bali for 2 weeks.
Oh, nice.
I booked two trips for him.
Beautiful.
And my daughter's going with her mum for 7 weeks or 5 weeks.
Your ex-wife now?
Yeah.
She's Thai?
Yeah.
So the... Do the kids speak Thai?
Yeah.
Okay, that's all right.
Oh, they're fluent in Thai.
Do you speak much Thai?
No.
It's great, isn't it?
Yeah. No, it's good. My daughter speaks Greek as well.
Oh, that's good.
Mm. She's good. She's fluent in both languages. My son...
That's okay, but when you go to Thailand, you can get the kids to translate for
you. Oh, yeah. Even now, we go somewhere and I take him to a place and I say to the... If we go to a Thai restaurant with him, I say to the girl, hey, talk to him in Thai because he understands Thai.
Yeah.
And he'll go, I said, no, don't get embarrassed. Just answer when she talks to you. So she'll say something and he'll sort of answer. And then the ladies, they get excited. Oh, you know, and they talk to him and he answers them again. Because his mum only talks to him in Thai.
Okay.
So she won't talk English to the kids.
Yeah.
Just Thai, you know. Oh. No, they speak, they understand two languages or three languages, English as well.
They reckon that people who are fluent in multiple languages or who learn multiple languages when they're kids. There's an increased level of cognition in their brains, so they're more likely to be able to retain information later in life.
Yeah,
and you know the
they're very smart. Both of them very smart. You know, they just they're good at everything and sports.
Yeah,
it's like they dominate in everything.
Do you reckon the kids will get into the weightlifting and the bodybuilding? And
he does. Both my daughter and him do jiu-jitsu. You've probably seen it, and they're good at it too. Yeah. You know.
How old are your kids now?
10 and... No, my daughter just turned 11, September 28th, and he turned 9.
I thought he was older than...
No.
Okay.
The daughter, she's the one who went on stage years ago when I competed. Your dad put her on stage. I don't think he was
Dad likes to put people's kids up on stage.
Yeah. She was like, you know... No, but they're both good, and he just did a swimming event. He killed them. They're good at swimming because I took them swimming as kids.
Yeah.
I like them to be able to swim, and they both dominate in the swimming. They dominate in track and field.
That's all right.
Football, AFL, he plays footy. He's always in their grand final, in their finals, he did 28 possessions, and they only 10 minute quarters.
Yeah.
Yeah. So in 40 minutes, 28 possessions. So many handballs, so many kicks, and so many...
Who were you doing the statistics for them, or...?
No, they did it. And
really?
When they were giving out...
Pretty impressive.
When they were giving a little awards, they were saying it.
Yeah.
And there they go, to Ethan Ioannidis, a man of the match every game. He's like... Because he grapples and fights and stuff like that.
Yeah.
If the ball's in there, the fathers all say it. If Ethan's near the ball, we don't worry. It's either he's going to come out with the ball or no one's going to take it out. He's either going to hold him down or he's going to come out with the ball. He won't let him get away.
That's good.
Yeah, he's like that. Just tackles him. That's it. You know?
Yeah.
But it's fun. I like that they're involved in sport and they like everything. Yeah. Now we're going to Thailand. I'm going to do a private lessons Muay Thai every day. And I'll do my gym training while he's doing that.
I had a chat to Vance Ang last week about Muay Thai.
Vance? Yeah.
And he's recently taken, or he's been doing French savate boxing, kickboxing for years. And we're talking about like the brutality.
I got the photo of you, me, and Vance. I just found it the other
day. Oh, really? I should put that up.
Yeah, I'll give it to you. I'll send it to you.
The Arnold, I think, a couple of years ago.
Yeah, it just came up on my, you know, how it come up on your
newsfeed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it just came up. I'll send it to you.
It was 2015 or 14 or something. It's a couple of years ago. We were talking about the brutality of training. Yeah. I did it when I was a kid, but in Australia, the kids are over in Thailand, where there was a guy that we knew
from this big man.
But they kick banana trees,
bamboo, and banana trees. But banana trees are soft, so it's all right, you know, because they're water. They're all water. If you get like that with something, it just breaks and just full of water inside, you know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but they're good. They're soft.
I always thought a banana tree was like quite.
No, I've got banana trees in front of the, my house was just on the canal there.
Yeah.
When I got divorced, I had to sell it, right? And I've got banana trees outside.
Oh, nice.
Massive. But once you've had bananas, you chop that bottom part down.
Yeah, and they
break in 2 seconds. You just go, they grow everywhere. There's roots coming everywhere. So you chop that one down, then I've eaten bananas off there.
Nice.
There's bananas on there now. It's not mine, but.
You should go down and have a look. Yeah. Steal some fruit.
No, there's bananas on there now, and they're really nice. They're little bananas like that.
Yeah.
Finger bananas.
So what do you reckon's next for you? Are you done with competing, or are you?
Oh, I don't think I'm done with competing. I just, you know, look, once I get my shoulders fixed, I'll think about it. I want to do one more show. I'd love to get in shape and get that do the over 50 and win it. I came close to it last time. I come second. So if I get that, I was talking to Johnny.
Moore.
No.
No.
Johnny. Another guy. Citroni.
Oh, John Citroni. Yeah.
And he goes to me, because somebody said, oh, John Citroni's won the junior, the mister, and the over 40.
He never won the junior.
No, I know. That's why he said to me. Now somebody else said it. And then I said to Johnny, hey, which universe have you won? He goes, no, just the normal one. He goes, me, if you win a master one, you're the only one who's going to win a junior Mr. Universe, who have won a junior universe, a Mr. Universe, and you're the only one who's going to win three categories.
Well, he won the Open, Mr. Universe. Then he went into the professionals, but he never won the pros.
Yeah.
However, he did win the short class in the pros.
But he didn't win the
No, in Nabba.
Because he used to compete against Arnold, remember?
Yeah, but that was in Nabba. In 67, 68, 69, when Arnold was competing. John competed against Arnold in the pros. Arnold won the tall class, John won the short class, and Arnold won the overall. So, you know, you can make of that what you like. But either way, John Citroni was...
Yeah.
But he competed with Nabba as a junior. I think he might have won the junior Mr. Britain years ago.
Yeah. No, because he said to me, you'll be the only one who wins all three classes if you win the over 50 years of me.
He won the Opens, the over 40s and the over 50s.
He's won the over 50s.
No, he did.
Has he?
No. I'm pretty sure
over 40, I think.
Because Dad beat him in the over 40s the first year.
Yeah, I know. But he won it, I think, later.
Yeah, he won it. I think he won it the second year. He's won...
Yeah, but I don't think he's done the over 50s. Is he?
I don't know. I have to check.
Yeah, check. Because he told me he's only won two classes.
Okay.
The two.
Like, I know he's one of those.
I've
like,
got it on my Facebook. Those stalwarts. He was talking to me.
I think he said to me years ago he's only ever missed one universe.
Yeah.
Since he was like a kid, he's been going every year.
Every year, yeah.
There's a lot of guys over in England that are like that.
Yeah, they don't miss a show.
Did you when you were competed over in England? Who were you sort of hanging around with over there? Were you with the Australian team? Because that would have been what the UBBA back then in Australia was sending guys to the Nabba Universe.
Look, I did a couple of years with Lopez, but they were Nabba then, weren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it was from the...
I didn't go UBBA.
Okay, because UBBA...
Just the once, whoever it was, remember when they had the two teams go over... That's the only time I went over. One was Billy Knight, went with somebody and this and that.
Yeah,
remember?
Well, it was Billy Knight and Gary Lua.
Yeah.
I think were both in the mix then.
Who did they go with?
Well,
no, Gary, they went with Paul. They went with, I think I went with your dad
And Peter McCarthy ran the UBBA.
Yeah, but they went with him. I didn't go with Peter McCarthy. I went with Paul Graham.
That was that was earlier, but Gary Lua went to the NABBA universe. I'm pretty sure I can't remember.
That's right. Did Gary Lua do the IFBB?
I don't think so. I don't know. I'd have to check. But
did he go there that year?
Well, he might have gone. But Gary Lua won the Mr. Australia three times with the UBBA.
Yeah.
That was after the split between Peter McCarthy and Paul Graham. Yeah. So, yeah. But then Joe Lopez came on the scene. But
then he started doing the NABBA.
He did NABBA Australia, which and then the UBBA sort of disappeared. But the UBBA had been connected to NABBA International.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, when Joe took over running it.
Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
So you came on board after.
I came on board after because I was doing IFBB. And your dad was doing the IFBB as well. We were doing the PWI and the IFBB, and then I went over before your dad.
Yeah.
Have you seen? Because I went in 86. Your dad came later.
All right. Do you keep in touch with Rocco?
No, I hear from him now and then because he lives up the road here.
Okay. He was on Facebook the last year or so promoting his ABBSO or ABB SSO or something, the Australian Bodybuilding Share Organization.
Yeah.
You ever seen any of that?
No. I can't remember. I heard something, but I can't remember. You have to.
Yeah. I know. It was all about just redistributing money to competitors and athletes and this and that. And it was just sort of very. It seemed like a very complex, complex arrangement for what ultimately becomes a very simple thing on the day.
Because,
you know, half the time you don't have, like he's talking about giving 3% of the total gross revenue to the person who places 10th and having 3-minute posing routines, all this sort of stuff. And you're like, yeah, I think, you know, it's kind of like, it seems
it'll
like
he
might have been out of the mix for too many years to, you know.
And what's he done? Nothing.
Well, he's not really done anything with it.
He's not going to do anything with it yet.
All right. Well, look. Do you remember when the PWBI folded? That would have been
a long time ago. That's when his gym went down. Everyone went down.
Yeah, sort of.
85, I think it would have been.
Okay.
He only had his gym open for 3 years.
Yeah.
He opened in 82, 83, 84, 85. 85, I think that would have been everything gone.
Because he was sort of doing the same stuff that Weta was doing on a much smaller scale. In that he had the magazine, he had the gym, he had the
everything, health food everything.
Stuff and all that. He was promoting himself as the guru.
Yeah.
And then it all...
Too many debts, too many companies, too many of this, you know. Yeah. Borrowed for everything.
I don't know. It's, yes, the history of Australian bodybuilding. Out of interest, when you were in the UK, did you ever go to Wag Bennett's house?
No.
No, he used to Wag used to.
I know Wag. Yeah, I know. You know him, yeah.
He used to have all the bodybuilders over to his house, and Arnold and all those guys.
They
all went over to his place and dinner. Wag often had people stay with him. So I thought, you might have.
I got on really well with Oscar Heidenstein.
Yeah,
I was like always in Oscar's office and He gave me all these photos and stuff. You know, he used to say to me, "Just go through all them boxes and take whatever you want." And the thing is, you know, I don't know what happened to him, but photos of Arnold and stuff like that, old photos and stuff, you know?
I can't
find them. I don't know what happened to him. No, seriously, he used to say to me, just go through anything you want, take, you know?
It's all right, it's pretty nice.
Yeah.
So what was Oscar like?
He's good.
For anyone who's listening and doesn't know, Oscar was the General Secretary of NABBA. He took that position up in 1955, and he served as more or less the head of NABBA. NABBA over in the UK and international, you know, until NABBA, 1991 when he passed away.
He never made any money out of it because there was no money to be made, really.
Yeah.
But he just loved what he was
doing.
Not
the way. I mean, I look at bodybuilding, I think, okay, there's money to be made if you want to make it.
Yeah.
But you've got to really approach it like it's a business and really treat people like shit.
They didn't want the publicity, they didn't want media attention, they didn't want anything, you know, NABBA.
Yeah.
He wasn't chasing it.
Yeah, well, he wasn't in it for the fame and glory. No. He was in it for that. And I think that's always the difference between NABBA and the IFBB.
Yeah.
NABBA was started as an amateur bodybuilding organization to promote bodybuilding, and it's remained that way ever since. It's very puritanical in its approach to what bodybuilding is. But I mean, I don't know, when did you meet Oscar first?
86.
And you, well, obviously
passed. And then I met him in 87, 88. And then, you know, then he kept in touch with me. They always kept in touch with me, you know.
Yeah.
But you know what? Every time I went there, he'd look after me. He'd throw me money and this and that, you know.
It's nice.
I didn't even ask for it. He'd, you know, give me like an envelope with some money and said, just pay for your food and stuff like that, you know. It was good. And he liked me going there because he'd say that, you know, when I'd go and see him after the first year, like 87, 88, he'd say to me, everybody would be ringing up asking if you're competing, you know?
No. And it's good to hear from there.
And he goes, all the girls are ringing up asking if he's competing. And he'd say to me, listen, leave him alone. He's coming with his girlfriend. His girlfriend Tracy's coming. So that, you know, he'd always say, he's come with his girlfriend, leave him alone. I used to, it was good. I had a good time with all the girls all the time, you know. I still have it. I'm just a friendly person, you know, just hang around.
Oh, that's it. You know, people, there's a saying that people don't remember what you say, they remember how you make them feel.
Yeah.
And if you make people feel good about themselves and you make, you know, you put the smile on people's faces.
You know what? I don't put people down and stuff like that. You know what?
There's a lot of miserable bastards in bodybuilding.
Oh, there is a lot. And, I know, I see it. But I just, I sit there and I, you know, I don't argue with no one. I'm not a person who's going to sit there and start saying, oh, yeah, this guy's this and this guy's that. Mm. You know? I talk to everybody. And to me, we all like, I don't know, I treat everyone the same.
Mm.
Guys, girls, different federations, this, that. We just talk, you know. And I'm easy to get on well with. So...
I've always found.
Keep your dad amused every time we go to see. He rings me when we go to England and stuff like that. He goes, if I'm not there, he'd fall asleep because we just talk all. He goes, you talk all the way. We drove from Heathrow to Manchester, and he goes, me fuck, you're lucky you were there because you spoke all the way for 4 hours just talking. otherwise, we'd have fallen asleep. You know?
Yeah, I've done a few long drives with him over the years, and it gets a bit. Yeah, you just got to keep talking, and that English countryside can get a little bit repetitive.
One year we drove around that. We couldn't get out of the airport. We drove around the airport about 6 times, and we kept on going past that plane that's there. You know, that's like a thing. So we just
got off that plane.
It was just a plane that's like a. It's like a big statue sitting in the middle of somewhere.
Yeah.
And we keep on driving around past this thing. We just could never get out of there. I think we spent about an hour and a half driving around in circles in the airport before we got out.
The NABBA Universe videos are all over YouTube. You can watch them all. But, you know, the over 40s, even the guys in the over 50s.
Tough competition.
It's just crazy.
The 40s and 50s are tougher than some of the classes because they're all...
Well, half the guys in the 40s and 50s are ex-pros.
Of course.
And you think, Christ, you know, give someone a chance. Give someone a chance. The guy who won the over 50s, Joao Obispo Andrade, was in the NABBA Pro League 10 years ago. And he retired from that when he turned 40. He won the over 40s, took a couple of years off, came back, he's won the over 50s twice. So, all right. What would your best advice be for someone who's starting out in the industry, in bodybuilding?
I think just stick to the basics, train hard, eat well, forget about drugs, because once you start thinking drugs, you're not going to get nowhere.
Mm.
You know what I mean? A lot of people, they think that it's all based around anabolics and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, I've been around for a long time. You know what? There's very few that are going to make it up the top there. And if you can't do majority of it by yourself and get the size and get this and get that, you know, you're not going to do it.
Yeah.
So you're always going to improve. But if you want to, and we're talking about competitors now, people want to compete.
Mm.
Just got to push yourself, train hard, eat well, you know.
Yeah.
I don't believe in bulking up too much because then you just got to lose it. I've got a guy I'm training at the moment. He goes to me, oh, he's an albino guy.
Yeah.
He won a few shows. I helped him this year, and he's won a few shows, but natural shows.
Yeah.
But he's up to 80 kgs now, and he goes to me, I want to get to 90. I said, you're going to get to 90? What for? and cut back down to 65. Yeah. You know, you get to 90 and cut back down to 65, you lose 25 kilos. What for? Stick around 80, 82, 83, 84, and cut back down to 70 or something, you know? Because you're not going to... It's useless gaining all that weight, then you get a cut. Because he goes, oh, last year I got to 80-something, and I cut before I met him, and he cut down to 62.
Oh, Jesus.
Now, what's your use of gaining, going up to 90 and cutting down to 60-something again?
That's crazy.
I mean, I was showing him photos of Robert.
Yeah, Robert.
And I said to him, look, Rob, this guy, he competes at 65, 66, 67 kilos, you know? So I think 68's the heaviest he's been, isn't it?
Something yeah, like I think he was on stage once at 68. I think that might have been the Asia Pacific this year. He did the Universe at 67, and he was like,
"Yeah, that's what I mean." I said to him, "You know, look at the shape and the quality of the muscle."
Yeah. But I mean, Rob's a great bodybuilder, but he's got weaknesses.
Yeah,
and he knows that, and he poses in a way that. When you see the photographs of him, you go, Christ, the bloke's perfect.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of guys like that when you see them just standing relaxed. You can sort of start picking them apart. But I guess it's lucky that everyone's got little flaws and little weaknesses. Mm. There's very few.
But he's won overalls, isn't he?
Yeah, well, Rob won the WFF Universe Pro this year. He won the Asia Pacific Pro. He's. I don't know, he's won the Southerns, he's won the...
Yeah, he's won a few shows, I don't know, he's done good.
I don't think he ever did the Australia. It's one of those ones, like, guys often, they did season A or season B.
Yeah. So who's that short guy that did win the Australia? We never competed again.
Not Jimmy Vuzas.
No, not Vuzas. He's got fucking that many faults, but gets ripped, huh?
Yeah, he was crazy. He was crazy, but conditioning gets shredded.
He won the overall universe too, don't you remember? Yeah, Greece? Was it in Greece or somewhere?
2013, I think it might have been in Greece. Yeah. Same year that Callum won his junior title.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't know, there's a lot of people come and go.
Callum.
Hey, have you ever watched Generation Iron?
Yeah.
They've just released Generation Iron 2.
Oh yeah.
Or they just released the promos for it, and Callum's like all over it.
Yeah.
So apparently they're going to follow him around, and because he's.
The next Arnold.
Well,
he's not going to do
that. That's
nothing.
The thing. They keep touting you, this guy as the next Arnold.
It's thinks that he's himself. Nothing like it, you know.
But that's the thing. I mean, even with the guys doing the classic bodybuilding, the standard of the classic bodybuilding in the IFBB is very different from what was on the Olympia stage in the 70s.
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah, if you want to recreate that look of the 1970s, like, right, well, don't have striated glutes, don't get psychotically shredded, and, you know, keep a you know,
look
about you.
Yeah.
But the guys on the Callum will be up against, okay, he's probably going to be maybe a little bit heavier than them, but...
Callum's good. His body's too long.
His lats aren't wide enough.
No, and he's wide. Yeah, he just straight up and down at the back from the back, you know. It looks all right. It gets hard.
Yeah, look, I remember the first... It was funny, a couple of years ago when we ran the Lee Priest Classic, Callum made his WFF...
Over their pro debut. Came pro third, debut. Didn't he, or something?
Came third behind...
the two guys from Poland? Czechoslovakia, yeah.
So there was... Slavoj Bednar, who has won the Pro NABBA Worlds twice. And there was another guy, Philip Grisner, who was a Czech bodybuilder. He won his pro card at that show. And both of them placed in front of Callum.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I remember afterwards, Callum was like, oh, I'm not sure if this sport's for me anymore. I feel so dejected and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like...
Yeah, but he didn't send a chance to them guys. Them guys are good, man.
I'm like, okay, you've won junior universe titles. You beat a dozen other guys in Korea last year on the biggest stage. And okay, you placed third in your first pro show. Don't be that upset. It's not the end of the world.
He wants to win everything he enters.
Well, that's the thing. Yeah, he was used to winning everything that he entered up until that point. Even though he had competed in, he'd done NABBA and WFF in Australia locally, and he'd been beaten by Jake in the overalls, and you know some other people. But once he got to the into that stride where he was Mr. Universe, he was expecting to be Mr. Universe forever. And it was like, well, you know.
Yeah, but how would he go in a NABBA Universe? Nah, that's what I mean. It's all right for WFF, but not an ABBA.
Yeah, but again, you know, the WFF, if I put Robbie Begonia at 67 kilos up against James Llewellyn,
who's
90 kilos. Actually, well, there was probably a good example. There was a guy from Korea this year who was about 67, 68 kilos. Big quads, big arms, great lats, tiny waist, you know, very small joints.
Yeah.
And he looked absolutely outstanding. He was just so freaky. The shape on him was great. And then you've got James Llewellyn, who's a former IFBB pro, who's just... The guy's built like a tank. And you put them up against each other, and it's such a different look. You know, James is just muscle upon muscle upon muscle, and this guy was, you know...
Small joints.
It's just a very different look. And I'm looking at this guy going... That's WFF right there. That's what we were trying to create. Whereas James is very much a NABBA hardcore.
Big, thick, round.
Hard and heavy, sort of heavy hitter bodybuilder. But it was funny because the Korean guy who was 67 kilos placed second behind James.
And
I think, you know, look, if you put Rob Begonia up on that stage, he'd probably do okay. I mean, it always depends on who shows up on the day. He'll probably do well. But when you put him in the mix on the NABBA Pro lineup, it is a very different look.
Yeah.
You know, it's very much apples and oranges, but it's green apples and red apples. You know, you get
He'll look tiny next to these guys.
But,
he'll be in shape. Yeah. But if they're in shape, they're hard. Yeah. Like, you know.
But again, you compare the guys on the NABBA Pro lineup to the guys on the Olympia lineup.
Yeah.
And let's be honest, there is no comparison.
Yeah.
For a lot of them. Some of the guys who place outside of the top six, you could probably interchange them.
Mm.
Some of them are pretty, they shouldn't be up there. But the top six of the Olympia, they're just that sort of that untouchable,
of course,
level.
If you
place top six, and that's what I remember, what Lee said to me previously, like getting that top six at the Olympia is, you know that you're really, you're really in that upper echelon.
Well, anybody can win it.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, I think we've probably taken up enough of your time.
All right.
If people want to get in touch with you, Facebook's the easiest way.
Yeah.
You don't have? Do you have Instagram?
Yeah, I've got Instagram as well.
What's your Instagram handle? Is it at Sammy Ionides or
something? That's it. Something like that.
All right. I'll.
Something like that.
No Twitter. You're looking at me like, what the fuck's Twitter?
I think I'm on. I don't know. But I don't use Twitter. I don't use it.
No. So you're just on Facebook.
Facebook and Instagram. Yeah.
Facebook and Instagram. All right. And Balaclava Body World, if people want to come down and train with... How many times... Mr. Universe, Mr. World? Mr. World?
No, two times Junior Universe and then NABBA Universe and runner-up in the best in the world in Atlantic City. I should have won that one too. Joe Bucci. Now, you know what I'd spoon about that show? Because it was a good show. That Serge Newbray was there. It was Serge Newbray's federation, I think it was.
Okay.
George Snyder ran it.
Yeah,
I think he did. Did he have something to do with pumping iron, George Snyder?
George Butler.
George Snyder. No,
it was George Butler and Charles Gaines.
Yeah, right, and Charles Gaines. Yeah, but George Snyder rang it. Serge Newbro was there. Reg Park was there. They were all part of the thing. And the only other people that won it was Samir Banoot and Robbie Robinson.
Okay.
And I'm spewing. I didn't get that ring saying best in the world because you know what? I should have won that show. They gave it to Joe Bucci. He should have been placed.
Who the hell's Joe Bucci?
Nah. Big name American, big arms.
Yeah.
Invitation only show, but didn't know what condition I'm gonna roll up in. Serge Newbro knew what shape I would roll up in.
Yeah.
And then he was arguing with everybody to give me the trophy and the ring. Because Bucci shouldn't have got it.
Yeah.
And then George Snyder's trying to give me money, give me all the $8,000 for ripping me off.
To pay you off, Jesus.
Reg Park, everybody, there's big write-ups in the magazines. Yeah, I wrote up to LA and I've gone into Royal Gym over there. Yeah. Everybody come up to me, all the Joe Gold and all them in the old days, and tell me we heard what happened. And you know, I'm thinking, it doesn't matter.
That's water off a duck's back.
But it's that's the politics you get in bodybuilding. You don't, you know, whatever happens. Yeah. On that one that I asked your dad, that show that I lost in the over 50s.
Yeah.
I got, I think it was 7 firsts.
How'd you lose?
I lost because they had two people judging, judging. They gave me no scores. And then I got, a couple of seconds and stuff. Like the other guy got all seconds and won by a point. And I said, and the same with when that Aussie girl won. The Russian girl had most first. I said to your dad, ask him. Yeah, the Russian girl, what was her name? She's won a few of them.
Maria Kuzmina.
Yeah, and the other one that beat her was the Aussie girl. What was her name?
Not,
She's got a French name.
She went to the WBFF.
Yeah, she's got a French name.
She won the NABBA Worlds in...
And the Universe. Mary something.
Lasser.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, Anne-Marie Lasser.
Anne-Marie. And she shouldn't have won. Because that other one had mostly all first and a few shit scores, and then she ends up going, and then we spoke with your dad, and I said, did your dad give me the judging shit? He goes, I can't. He knew I was going to put them on social media. He goes, I can't give them to you.
Yeah.
I said, look, because he showed them to me.
Yeah.
I said, how come all the judges got me first and these two are here, and there wasn't an Aussie judge in there?
Yeah.
And I lost the show.
There's a lot of people who have been critical of bodybuilding.
And then your dad goes to me, what they should do, whoever gets them, you know, how to eliminate top and low.
Yeah.
Whoever gets the most first, if there's 11 judges and 7 give you first, you should win.
Yeah.
You know what the other judges are giving you, whatever they want. Then the fourth and an eighth, they don't know what they're doing.
Nah. I've seen judging sheets from. Yeah, all around the world, and it happens everywhere.
Yeah, they favour there.
Well, there's part of it is they favour there, but their own competitors. But there's also this issue of what might be the ideal bodybuilder in France is slightly different from what's the ideal bodybuilder in Korea or in Australia or in the USA or Brazil or the Czech Republic. And you've got all these people with their own mindsets around what they're looking for as the ideal physique.
Yeah,
and usually it'll be usually they get the first person is correct
unless their guy's up there and it looks like you can win it.
But you know, like we've had situations, or I've known situations where national presidents just get up and walk out of the judging panel because their person doesn't win. They crack the shits and they walk off and they don't come back and they leave the show, and you're like, okay, we're about 5 hours into a 10